What's going on, everyone? Jonathan here with the Venue RX podcast. And today I am joined by Meryl Snow of Snowstorm, which I think is such a cool name. I absolutely love it. Meryl, thanks for being here.
Thank you, Jonathan. I'm happy to be here. This is exciting. Uno, dos, tres.
Well, this is going to be a wonderful discussion today. We're talking about a couple of my favorite things, namely team. I love team dynamics, and then also sales. And I know you have so many incredible resources on your website, and I can't wait to kind of plug you a little bit later at the end of the show, because I'm hoping that people go and check you out. And if you're listening to this on podcast platform, we do have a YouTube channel where you can see Meryl's smiling face and myself as we're talking about this. But I'm pumped for today's topic. How did you get into events? I mean, I'm fascinated with how people get into events. So how did you get into this industry?
By accident.
I love it.
Well, I was in college and I met my husband.
Okay.
And we decided that when we graduated, we were going to open up a string of gourmet delis. Now, this is in the late 80s, and there was no such thing as gourmet delis, but we wanted to be, because he's a chef. I was in business, but we wanted to do these gourmet delis, and we found one. We were going to start with one and then do a string of them. So we found one, we borrowed money from our parents, we pulled all of our money together, and we put an offer in. He accepted the offer, we're on our way, and then he pulls back the owner of the deli because he raised the price $25,000 because of capital gain. We were crushed. I mean, because this was our plan. We planned it for a long time. We were always in the restaurant business, you know, throughout college and high school. And we thought, this is the way we're going to go. This is how we're going to make our dent in the industry. Then it just all came crumbling down. And then I got pregnant. So we get pregnant. Then we do our daughter's christening because he's a chef. I've always been in the restaurant business. I mean, I was brought up in the restaurant business. So we thought we would, and we catered it in our backyard. So all of our family and friends were saying, well, why don't you just go into catering? Like catering. Then I thought about it. This is so catering so much better than restaurants, because restaurants, you are dictated to opening and closing. Catering, mm-hmm. You can say, yeah, I'll take this job, or no, I don't want this job. Right. Mm-hmm. So you can really be flexible. So we started that, and we didn't look back. I mean, that the catering at that time was like, I don't know if you remember, like steam table death, like Schaefer, and just food, just, and it smells. And that's the time we entered catering. So we knew that we could change the evolution of catering. And that was really cool to us. And then maybe 3 or 4 years into it, then at that time, event planners were these old ladies with blue hair drinking martinis, and they were useless, useless. So we knew that, okay, we're going to have to start another company, and we have an event planning company now. And then maybe 4 or 5 years after that, then I'm working with the client on this fabulous tablescape, and I'm so proud of it. I'm at the event. I'm setting it up. I'm loving it. I step back to just get the full picture, and this florist puts this god-awful centerpiece right in the center of my beautiful table. And I'm like, no, 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 that does not go there. And the florist said, well, the bride ordered it. And I was like, it was orange carnations, first of all, which is awful. And baker's fern. Any florist out there knows what orange carnations and baker's fern's like. And at that point, I said, I am starting a design division. So that's how we started all three of our divisions. And in business, I think that's how most people evolve with their businesses. So now we have three really successful businesses that are still going strong, which, well, even in the pandemic.
Yeah, no, absolutely. And I've seen a lot of different businesses that were strong pre-pandemic who were positioned correctly, you know, still do, maybe not, like you said, very well. You kind of, you know, yeah, wiggled your hand a little bit. Exactly. the companies, though, that were strong and did have that stable base were able to kind of, you know, close down a little bit, you know, hunker down and figure out, okay, what are we going to do? Are there subtle pivots that we need to do? So what are there some pivots that you've seen? Are you just kind of continued on?
This COVID brought our industry to its knees. I mean, it was the whole hospitality industry, and it was devastating. I'm not making light of the other companies that are out there in the world, but I'm just saying in our own neck of the woods, the hospitality industry, we were crushed. Mm-hmm. And it was hard to see big companies closing down because they didn't have the right infrastructure, or their overhead was just way too high, or they're leased out to forever. And that was very, very difficult. But a lot of companies did different things. And I know a designer is actually a friend of mine, Sasha Souza. Instead of going out to her clients and pulling in money, she went in to the business to business, to other designers. And she started this course, and she started saying, this is a perfect time to teach. So I thought that was really smart. That was a great pivot. In the catering industry, some people did the box meals, the frontline workers, they did all that, yet they weren't making money, but they were keeping busy. Mm-hmm. We opted, because we are a high-end catering company, planning company, and design company, and we did not have that business model to do these drop-off type things. I mean, that's not what we did. We just did large, big events. So we decided we weren't going to pivot. We were going to rein everything in, mm-hmm. be lean and mean. You know, we furloughed our people, but they were paid well. You know, thank goodness for the stimulus. We brought them back as soon as we got our PPP. So that was a smart move for us, but it's not smart for everybody. You know, absolutely. So everybody had to really look into that. Now, I don't do the day-to-day in my business anymore, except for I still deal with our sales staff. So what I normally do is I work with companies in our industry all over the country. And this has been very, very difficult because of, gosh, I was just talking people off the ledge. You know, it was really hard. It was hard for everybody. But we see the light. It is happening. It is coming back. And I got to tell you, weddings, you wouldn't even know that there was a pandemic talking to some of these brides.
That is so true. That is so true. And just as some of the inquiries that we have, even in the last, and we're here in California, and so things are still kind of slowly opening up. But, you know, we are starting to get those inquiries for people in August, September. Things are supposed to open up in our economy June, like mid-June. But for August and September, they're like, hey, where are we at? Like, can we have like a 250 person event? Like, they're ready.
Big, you know, dance floor.
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. There's a lot of pent up demand. But that's really cool to hear how you chose to handle it. I think a lot of people did kind of work within what their wheelhouse was, or maybe things that they wanted to experiment with. I know some catering companies that were kind of like, we've always wanted to try a delivery program. Like, let's see how it goes. And some people, they shut it down, and some people it stuck. So that's,
we knew what a delivery program was like, because we've been in business for 32 years now. So we've tried all these things for extra revenue. Mm-hmm. And we realized early on, we're staying in our lane. We know what we're really good at. And that's mm-hmm. when we decided to just pull back and just pull in the reins.
Totally. So that's incredible. With 30 plus years of experience in this industry, you are uniquely positioned, I feel like, to, you know, provide advice, because you've seen quite a few things in our industry. And so you do have a coaching platform now. Is that correct?
I do. Yeah.
Tell me about that a little bit. Who do you serve, a certain type of client?
My client is anybody in the special event industry.
Okay.
And what I've been doing pre-COVID is going to the clients, helping them with their business, their sales team, setting up sales teams. I mean, we're nothing without sales. So that's why I want to spend a lot of time making sure that their systems are set up right, that the compensation plans are set up right. And this makes total sense, because it has to be a win-win for the salesperson and the owner. It's got to be a win-win. Mm-hmm. And that's what I've been doing.
What are some things that you see when you start working with some of your clients who come in? Maybe they don't have any sales team at all or any sort of sales process. What are some things that you see as like the first thing that they can do? Or maybe something that makes the biggest difference.
Even if you are one person doing the sales, mm-hmm. you have to have a system. And you have to have them set up, the policies and procedures, a training manual, everything, because eventually you're going to have a second salesperson, hopefully, mm-hmm. right? So, and even if you're not, to have these systems, see, here's the problem, Jonathan, in our industry, that most of the people in our industry are in this because they have a passion for what they do, whether they're musicians or bakers or florists. I mean, they have a passion. That doesn't mean they're business people. Mm. And that is all across the country. I see this. And actually, it's all across the world. I see this, that, you know, our industry is that they have this passion and they put the business secondary. Mm. And that is the one thing I remember my father told me, the best advice I ever had early on when we started. He was, you know, Meryl, I just want you to remember that you're running a business that happens to be a catering company, but you're running a business first. And I thought, and that stuck with me forever, because when I wanted to throw in an extra wheatgrass in or more hors d'oeuvres or something like that, I pulled back and it's like, they're not paying for that. That goes right out of my profit. So that I always remembered. And I think that I spend a lot of time teaching our industry that we've got to run like a Fortune 500 company, because if we don't, we're going to be solopreneurs for a long time working in our business and working our butts off. We've mm-hmm. got to scale our company, even though some people say, oh, I don't want to get so big. That's fine. But you got to get big enough that you could walk away for a week and somebody else is running it.
Absolutely. And it comes down to just the overall health, right? Of you as a person and the creativity that, because after a while, yeah, you're right. We do as wedding pros, we work our butts off and then, you know, it's so easy to burn out after, you know, a couple of 12 or 16 hour days or something. And I know you've probably been there before.
Well, I have. And the thing is, when we decided, there's a big decision to make. When you get to $1 million in business, there's this huge decision to make whether to scale down a little bit between 500 and 750, because that means you're working in your business, but you're not overextended. You're making a decent living and your profit margin's okay. When you get to the $1 million mark, that's the hardest part. You have to make that decision whether I'm going to grow this from a million to five to 10 to 20, or you're going to say, I need to step back. And that time period of $1 million, you are working your butt off, you are burnt out, but you know that there is this level that you're getting to, and they do get to that level. And once they get to that level, because I know it, because they call me and they say, I can breathe. I have people in place. I have policies and procedures in place. I can manage my business instead of working my business. And I think that is the big bell that goes off and says, okay, I get it.
Mm-hmm. Can you take me back to that time, maybe where you were in a similar place of growing your company and putting those policies and procedures in place? Were there some key people that you had to hire, maybe a first couple hires, or like, tell me about that space. Cause
I made a huge mistake in the beginning.
Okay.
This is real early on. I never hired anybody smarter than me. And that was an ego thing, which was totally wrong. Totally wrong. And I get why people do that and they don't admit it. And I would never admit it until years later, but I didn't. I wanted to be the know-it-all, right? Mm-hmm. I wanted to train them. And until I realized that I don't have all the answers. And in order for me to successfully build this business, I need to have people that are smarter than me, or not maybe smarter than me, different skill set than I have. And that is when I really got into the personality assessment, because I think that is really important. Let me give you an example of that. I had an executive chef and I would send him an email and he would read the email because I had the read receipt. and he wouldn't answer me. And I would get so aggravated because I'm thinking that he is just disrespecting me. He doesn't, you know, he's not answering. It'd be days until I get an answer. I'd walk into the kitchen and he still wouldn't say anything. Then after studying personalities, my personality is I get an email, I read it, I answer it and send it out. His personality is he reads an email. He needs to sleep on it. He reads it again. He wants to think about it. And then he answers. Either way is not right or wrong. It's just different personalities. So that's why in working with the team, knowing each other's personalities and knowing what they can contribute to the team and what can irritate the team. But knowing that ahead of time makes it so much easier.
Mm-hmm. I want to take this in kind of an interesting direction. What do you think about family members who run businesses together? Because this is like a team. This is very much, I mean, you are on a team, but you might be co-owners or maybe, you know, yeah. You have a mother, daughter, father, son, mother, son combo where, you know,
you do know that I'm working with my husband, right?
No. Okay. So this is, makes it even better.
Oh, I live it.
I love it. Okay. So then let's talk about this. So what are some ways, because the team is not necessarily fireable. You know what I mean? You know, and so this poses some unique problems. You leave work and you go home, but you're really kind mm-hmm. of probably for a lot of us pros, we're all kind of together. I know I work with my wife and I see her at the office and then 5 minutes later at home and we kind of take our hats off, right? And put the new
that's
the
exactly hat on. That's exactly it. I'm so glad you said that, Jonathan. And early on, we needed to. And we did this intentionally. We said, okay, we're going to write a list of everything that you do and everything that I do. And let's write this list. And then we're going to decide who's taking ownership of this. Mm. And then we have our job description. So if mine was the salespeople, let's say, and he didn't like something that a salesperson did, he would mm-hmm. never direct it to the salesperson. He would direct it to me and then I would deal with it because then it was confusing for the employees to be talked to two different employees. So that was one of the big things that we stayed in our lanes and then okay. we would discuss it in private. And I would say, no, Andy, you're wrong. You know, or I say, okay, you're right. But the point is the employees aren't being in the middle of it. So we've always had this equal front, right? But the 24 hours a day thing, that's hard. And so once we picked our lanes and we don't have to be in the same, we don't have the same offices, we're not in the same, you know, in the same room. But once we left the business, once we went home, we didn't talk about the business unless it was an emergency or we were firing somebody or something that we just needed some private time because we had a daughter. And one thing that we did not want her to feel how busy we were because early on we started this business and then I got pregnant, remember? So mm-hmm. this was, we were working a lot. So we decided that she would never know how busy we were. We would always be home at 5:30 for dinner, both of us. So all three of us were together. And if somebody had to go back to work, we would go back to work after she's put to bed. So this way we can still get our stuff done, but she never knew. And to this day, she said, I never knew how busy you were. I think you had a cake job because she was talking about going into the business. I'm like, it's too much work, even though it's set up for her, right? It's totally set up, but it's a hard business. Mm-hmm. So that's one thing that has really worked. We stayed in our lanes. We had an equal front in front of the employees and we didn't talk about work at home. And we went to every one of our daughter's games. It's, you know, people say, I just don't have time. Well, you block it off on your calendar. You just have to be a little organized in time management.
Well, I was going to ask, what things did you learn? I mean, it sounds like you just mentioned time management, but what other character traits or disciplines or whatever did you learn through this? Because, I mean, I can just think, I mean, I've my wife and I have talked about this, and it's like, oh, we don't necessarily want to talk about work either, but inevitably she'll bring something up or I'll bring something up. And it's, we both care. We're both passionate. We both love what we do.
So, we have a bell.
Okay.
We have a bell. So if I come home and I'm really upset about something, or I've got a great idea or something like that, I'll ring the bell and I can say the amount of time that I want. So I need an hour and I'm ringing this bell. I need an hour. And then he's focused. Okay. Right? He's focused on what I want. And then after that hour, I better stop until if he says you can continue and vice versa. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah.
Because there is going to be times you have to talk about it. I mean, there's no way around that.
Yeah.
So, but if to make it fun, I mean, we've married 30 some years. So to make it fun, we do the bell thing. We do talk about it. We cook dinner together. You know, we were doing things that normal people did, because that scared me in the beginning. Mm-hmm. I saw this coming. I saw what it could be, because we were working and we were coming home and we were working on this and we were arguing about things. And I said, oh my God, our life, what is our life going to be like? And we just figured it out. And it's not like it's, I did come to this epiphany. It was like, oh my God, what's going to happen to us? And then what's going to happen to the business if we break up? Right. So that's when we just sat down and said, okay, this is it. This will work. And it we still haven't changed the plan. It still works.
Wow. That's so inspiring. I feel like a lot of times when young couples think about running a business together, it is very idyllic in their minds. And it's very exciting. Like, you have these skills, I have these skills. Let's put them together. Let's do this. Let's open a venue together. I'm a photographer. You're going to be a videographer, right? Like, right. There's a lot of those dynamics in our industry, but mm-hmm. I feel like the thing that repeatedly bugs people is like, oh my gosh, I've heard it's terrible to work with your spouse. I've heard don't do it. And so where do you think that comes from? Why do you think people should be scared or worried or concerned about that?
Well, I think they should be until they set up the parameters.
Okay.
Because early on, I saw what was going to happen. I mm-hmm. saw this. I saw, oh my God, if this continues.
So you were thinking the same thing.
What?
You were thinking the same thing. Oh, this could be a problem.
This could be a problem. And I was thinking that early on. And that's when we decided to. Now, the good thing is Annie and I are very, very similar, except for he's an introvert and I'm an extrovert, which is fine. I can't share the stage with anybody. But so we do have the same moral compass and business strategies and things like that. So that was very helpful. Now, I always suggest people take this personality test, and you and your wife should take it, because it's just really interesting to see what strengths that they have and what weaknesses or areas of improvement, and how you can compensate by knowing each other's pros and cons, basically. And in taking over, like, I hate insurance shit. I'm sorry.
You're fine.
And what I do with it is I look at it as like, because that was originally on my list. And I just finally said, I have no interest in dealing with this insurance. I could care less about the truck insurance or medical insurance. I said, I'm not, my heart's not into it. And he took it over for me. And I said, what do you want me to take over? And he said, nothing right now, but let's put a pin in that, because I may give you something. Right. So. And that's how it works. It's just, I think it's communication mostly. Uh-huh.
Totally. Well, I love that.
Don't get me wrong. We have arguments. I'm not going to lie. I mean, now, don't you think it's like all pretty over here? It's not. But we're doing our best.
That's what you can do. And it sounds like you are very collaborative. I think that is the hardest. Those team members are maybe the hardest ones to work with. But let's shift. Let's talk about bringing on other team members. So you said very early on you didn't want to hire anyone smarter than you. What helped you get over that?
Because I didn't see my sales growing as fast as I would like them to. Mm. And so this was year three when I came to this epiphany that I'm not the smartest person in the room And I'm literally not the smartest person. So that was my big epiphany. And mm-hmm. I started interviewing and hiring people that I should be hiring. And then I saw, and I knew what I was really good at. I am really good at setting up teams, doing compensation plans, and being a big cheerleader in the front of the house type of thing. And I know what I'm not good at. I know the stuff that bores me. And I have to hire people that excel in the stuff that bore me. And then, you know, that's how I continue to hire. It works out well. But the personality testing, that has been a lifesaver for me for 30 years doing this personality test. We use the Myers-Briggs. It's really easy. And use that too.
You literally read my mind. It was crazy. But I was just about to ask, well, what personality test do you use? And then you just it was like you answered it directly from my
mind.
We're
like this, Jonathan. We're like this.
I love it. I love it. So Myers-Briggs, do you use any other tests?
No, because I know it. I know it really well. I know what personality types that I can't work with personally. Mm-hmm. And I don't hire those people because we would just clash. And looking back on things where I didn't use the science. I used my gut when hiring. And then I looked at the personality test and I'm like, that's why, you know, that's what happened, because there's certain people that just clash. I mean, we know that in life that, mm-hmm. and it could be from their personality. So, you know, I used to think that personality tests were like horoscopes, like, oh, please, that's bullshit. You know? I really got turned around on this when somebody actually called me and wanted to do their thesis, and they wanted to come in and do our team. And that's when I realized that our executive chef, who I was about to fire, just has a totally different personality. And I had to understand his personality and he had to understand mine. So what happened with that? Remember, I'm the one that types it and sends it away. He's the one that reads, sleeps on it. So we decided that he can still read and sleep on it, but he has to acknowledge that he got the email. That was all it took. So, and that's what happens when we do have some conflict of, just because I don't want everybody to do everything my way, because I wouldn't grow that way. However, I think we as humans secretly want people to do everything our way, right?
Yeah. Or we think that our way is the best way. And so, yeah, we're like,
That's it.
You should obviously do things my way. I love this. I think this is a good way to think about it, because as you're thinking about hiring people who are better than you at certain things, those people, if they are really good, they likely have, you know, strong opinions about what they do. And if you have those clashing opinions and you're not willing to communicate, you are right. You're putting yourself at a disadvantage because you won't be able to work with them. So that's really, really, really cool. So you've been using Myers-Briggs for a while then. When you hear business owners say phrases like, oh my goodness, it's impossible to hire good people nowadays. I can't find anyone. I put a post out on it, you know, Indeed or LinkedIn or Craigslist or Facebook, whatever it is, right? And I get all these applications back. What do you have a response to?
Are you talking pre-COVID or COVID? Because COVID, it's a different world right now. We can't get any of our people back to work.
Let's talk pre-COVID because I do want to talk post-COVID, but let's talk pre-COVID.
Pre-COVID, I think there is a technique in hiring the right people. And because we put these ads out and we expect to get all these resumes back, and we do, but we're not asking the right questions. So our method is that we send out a post, whether we're sending it out for event producers, designers, whatever it is, prep cooks. And we do that. And in that, we say to them, please call the number and let us know why you think you're good for this position. And we also have a link for them to fill out the online application, right? Mm-hmm. So it's amazing to see how people call, what people say when they call, because voice is like the first impression that we're getting. We're not seeing them. So if I hear somebody really energetic, I'm just going to be so great for this job because da 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 da. Or somebody says, I don't know. I just need a job. I need, you know, it really depends on who we're hiring. But the point is, like, if that was an event producer, I would not even call them back. Mm-hmm. Right. But the ones it's all bubbly. So the ones it's all bubbly, then we send that person a survey and we ask a series of different questions because I want to see how they handle things. Mm. And then we send them the survey and now we'll set up an interview if we like the answers to the survey.
Definitely. Could you give me some examples of a couple, like, would you be willing to share with us a couple of examples of, like,
I can give you the whole list, but I mean, they're not the questions that they teach you in college. These okay. are questions that are so off that, you know, off. And one of them would be, so tell me about your last boss and tell me what you, wait a minute. I can't remember. It's been a long time since I've had to interview anybody. It's been a year, you know.
Yeah. Oh, we're all out of practice. We're all, you know, stretching again, remembering how to, like, you know, shining up our non-slips.
Yeah. What did you think of your last boss? And if they start going in, he could have done this better. This was awful. This was, if it's all negative, or they could say, well, I think, you know, in a more positive way. Do you know what I'm saying? And I don't know how they're going to answer it, but the point is I'm seeing if they're a loyal employee, I'm seeing if they can skirt around things easily. I mean, they may have hated the boss, but how they're answering it is really important to me. Mm. One of them would be, how did you prepare for this interview? And if somebody says, well, I bought a new dress and I brushed my teeth and I did my hair. Or somebody may say, oh, I did my homework. I know that you boom, boom, boom. I know the company done, you know, and then I know, okay, they want this job. So these are different questions that we ask. And it truly works because we're taking them off guard. Mm. And that's exactly what I want to do, because in our industry, especially higher management or salespeople, they're being taken off guard all the time. So they yeah. have to be able to think on their feet.
Yep. This is so cool. I think that wedding pros listening to this, and I'm here writing, I mean, my paper is just going to be full of these notes, right?
Oh, I love that, Jonathan.
Well, it's amazing what you're saying, because I think a lot of people, they do struggle with hiring, obviously with pre-COVID. Now, post-COVID, what type of environment are we in? Because you are right. There's a kind of, it's a weird new world, but the needs are still there. And we're kind of coming roaring back with events. What type of scenario are we in now? How are you handling it?
We are not in a good scenario all across the country because, and I was so appreciative of the government stepping in to help our people with the stimulus. But we've got to get back to work. And these people are not coming back to work because some of them are making more money with this stimulus and unemployment than they were, especially with servers and rig people and, you know, things like that, that they're making more money staying at home. And it was a long time. It's been a year. So it's been very difficult. And on the flip side, the people that do want to work have left the industry because they realize that, look, this is not going to bounce back quickly. This was like 6 months ago to a year, and they were right. So they got out of the industry altogether. And now they're realizing, oh, I have benefits. I work 9 to 5. I don't work weekends. Mm-hmm. This is nice. So we've lost a big chunk of really good qualified people. That is it, and that is truly an issue where I'm trying to set up around the country in different markets, these teams and I'm working with NACE, these teams to work together and do a referral program, because a rental company may have done all their rentals the day before, but all their people may be free today, you know, on that Saturday, and be able to do something like that. So it's starting to shape up, but it's still a very scary very scary. And as a matter of fact, for my own company, I'm teaching a course at a university so I can capture these kids and work. So we have to be really creative and thinking like the our methods of hiring pre-COVID would never fly right now. They would laugh at me. But when they need all this work, they don't need it now. They're sitting pretty.
Yeah.
And they're not even coming to, but this is the best part. You finally get them in for an interview and they don't show up.
I've heard this so much. We've experienced it in our own company. So we actually, I'm sad you're not in our own market here. We run an event staffing company. And so we literally
closed up. You're kidding. Two of ours closed. Have an event. Yeah, that's great. How are you doing with that?
So it has been challenging to bring people back. I mean, we had close to 900 people, right about 900 people in the Southern California area pre-COVID. And of course, then with COVID happening, you know, a lot of those people, some of them stayed in our ecosystem and some of them got out of the industry, just like you said.
Yeah, right.
And as we're trying to bring people back, we have our team here reaching out, saying, hey, we have shifts, you know, the pay is even more, like there's a lot of opportunity now, but for the majority of folks, they are just not interested in back. And so I definitely think though, I love what you said about teaching the university courses. And I think that there's different things that creative companies will do to recruit maybe new talent that hasn't had the opportunity to be in the industry or doesn't understand the industry for what it is. And
right.
Would you agree with me, Meryl, that our industry in the 30 plus years you've been in business, right? This industry is pretty recession proof, isn't it?
Weddings are. Well, you know, it's funny that you said that because in 2008, and I don't think you didn't have your business in 2008, right?
No, 2014 is when we started.
Okay. So 2000 what? 14?
14, yeah.
Okay. Yeah. In 2008, that was the big financial crisis.
Yeah.
And that we bounced back up, but that seems like a cream puff compared to what COVID did to businesses. But it is recession proof, except for a pandemic, because I'm telling you, these brides would have had their wedding if they were allowed to, no matter what. You know, they didn't care. And this postponing, and it's funny when these perfectly normal people become brides, something happens to them, right?
For all of the pros listening to this, you know exactly what Meryl is talking about, where the comments are going to be like, and for any brides, we love you, you know, grooms, but you know, Meryl's right. You're totally right. It happens.
I mean, I saw it in my niece who was a Harvard graduate, high level job position. And she's now a bride. And oh my God, she was like, I said, you are the epitome of every bride that I've talked to during this time. And I get it. I do get it. And in planning so many events, I mean, this is a truly a big deal, but
totally, totally. Well, let's talk. So we talked about hiring people. We talked that really the old methods aren't necessarily going to be working. But now we're here in this kind of new environment. And so we have to think in different ways about hiring, recruiting. You know, we have to think really carefully about how we position our businesses as we come back. I think, you know, I've definitely seen in our own business a huge, just tremendous uptick in requests that are coming through. I mean, there's regularly shifts and things that we can't fill. The question is like, how do we do it? How do we handle it? And there we think about sales. We think about hiring. So when you think about sales, and I want to talk about sales, hiring, and building sales teams, this is something that you've obviously done. How do you think about building a sales team? Like what would be a first step for you? If someone's listening to this.
Well, yeah. But prior to that, if you don't mind, if I talk about right now in sales, because I think that's a bigger issue because we do have to build our sales team, but we need the sales to get to that point because I will not tell somebody, you need salespeople, go hire 4 salespeople, not in this environment. Right now we got to pull back. And in our industry, we rely on venues a lot. So venues are my clients. I treat the venue as my top tier client, not the bride and grooms. It's the venue. That's the one that is bringing me revenue, right? Mm-hmm. So this is the time to nurture these. I mean, they're hurting too, and not being transactional. Don't call up a venue and say, you know, when are we going to get this done? You know, don't be transactional. It's treat the venues, because we have venues too. And I know how that some people treat us and some people don't, right? And or they forgot all about us. And then when we're open again, hey, here we are. You going to send me business? Yeah. So we really do need to nurture these relationships. It's really, really important. Just like we would nurture any other client relationship, your top tier clients, you've got to use these venues. And I don't care if you're a florist, a DJ, a musician, anybody needs to really nurture these venues. And, you know, they took a big hit too. And they may even turn around and start charging the industry pros money to be on their list or whatever. A lot is going to happen. But if you are one of the people that are in front of them and talking to them, and I know Andy, my husband, he's talking to every venue because they're hurting and they are thinking of ways, but at least he is part of the conversation. And he is able to say, okay, it still needs to be a win-win. If we're going to charge if you're going to charge us, then we have to charge the client, but we have to be very careful not to price it out of the market, right? The whole combined thing. So that has to be talked about. So curating your venues, I think is just top. Then as it picks up and you get more sales, then you go back to, okay, I need more salespeople. Now you have to remember, Jonathan, and I know you know this, is that, you know, we're all startups again, but we're startups with the knowledge that we didn't have. We have that knowledge that we didn't have when we first started our companies. So we need to just like start thinking about that and thinking about what we've learned and how to move forward quicker. Because, you know, when people say, oh my God, I don't have any business, I'm a startup again. I was like, yeah, but you know what to do. Yes. And you've got to do this stuff. 100%. But they get scared, and then it's hard. It's very hard. Mm-hmm. It's just hard.
I love that you said that we're all kind of in startup phase. Obviously, different people who have been impacted more or less are starting at different levels, but there was such a massive pullback. And so in a lot of fun ways, it's leveling the playing field, possibly, for some folks who may have, you know, the knowledge, they've studied, maybe they've learned some lessons. They weren't running the most successful business in 2019, but they've learned some stuff. They've learned how some stuff doesn't work. And now here we are, as things start coming back, they can really start implementing some of that. So you're not starting from zero. You're starting from that knowledge platform. That's so encouraging. Exactly. And anyone listening to this right now, you are starting with a knowledge platform. Don't be discouraged. Absolutely. Absolutely.
Right. And I have to say, the people that are listening to this are probably still in business. Absolutely. And I've got to give you a big kudos for that, because you've weathered this storm. And I know how many companies have closed their doors.
Yeah.
I know how many shut those doors. So kudos to you guys for surviving this. And it's not easy. This is the worst thing that has ever happened in the 100 years since the last pandemic. I mean, we never have been paused like this. Mm-hmm. So kudos.
Definitely. And now that we're maybe potentially right getting to the other side of it, I think it's a very exciting time. You know, if you've waited it out, if you still are in this industry, you know, if you are listening to this podcast and wanting to grow your business, you know, this is a cool time. This is a time where you can grow. So Meryl, your career, you've really done a lot of different things. You've touched a lot of elements of the industry, productions, you know, design, the catering, now with coaching. Are there other sectors of this industry that you are looking at that you like you think about what you're doing? What do those look like?
What I'm working on now, which was, always had a course, and that was my triangle method sales training platform. And I always had that. I've had that for 5 years. But since COVID and talking on Clubhouse. Are you familiar with Clubhouse?
Oh, yeah, absolutely.
Are you on it?
Oh, definitely. In fact, this just...
Oh, I have to follow you, Jonathan.
Let's do it. I'm so excited. So we actually... this morning I was on listening to Gabby... I'm forgetting her name.
Well, I know who you're talking about.
Yeah, she has this whole thing on Pinterest. Anyway, we definitely need to follow each other. It's just Meryl Snow.
Totally. Yes.
Yeah, okay. Yeah, yeah. So everyone listening to this, also go to Clubhouse. If you don't know what Clubhouse is, Meryl's about to tell you, and then go follow her. So that's perfect.
Clubhouse is an amazing audio app. And to be honest with you, I was not going on this app. And the only reason why I had to is because I'm a speaker and they were doing this all day speaking thing. And I was part of it. So I had to go on. So I figured, all right, I'll sign in. And then I'm looking for where's the video button? Yeah, there you go. And I'm looking for the video button. It's like, there's no video button. This is an only audio app. And I'm like, oh my God. And I'm a speaker and I play off of people. That's why when you said, Jonathan, that we're doing Zoom, I'm like, oh good. Because at least you can see people and talk to them. So, but it is an amazing app. And right now, most of the people on there are businesses, don't you think, Jonathan?
Absolutely. I think
small businesses, I mean, and I'm learning so much and I'm giving a lot. So this has been so since Clubhouse that, you know, how I do my topics, I don't know if I mentioned I'm a speaker. I've been speaking for about 22 years. And the way I've always done my topics is if I hear a question asked of me three times, that's a topic for me because that means more people want to hear about this. And I've heard about how do I become a speaker? How do I get on those stages? And I thought, okay, I'm going to start a course called Rock That Stage. So I've been working on that. So that's been a lot of fun, but
very cool.
I don't know if I answered your question.
Well, you totally did. We talked about Clubhouse, but I think that you were just mentioning the education piece. And I think that's an incredible place to add and pivot. And you're not even adding it. You know, you've been doing it for 20 years. But
it's a natural progression.
Yeah.
You know?
But
I really believe that people want education, but they need it to transform their business because you can buy a book on anything, but it's not going to transform your business. So working with a consultant, a coach, a speaker, whatever, to transform your business is a whole new thing. And I think that Clubhouse has done that for our industry or for all industries.
Totally.
So I think it's really good.
Yeah. I love the fact that Clubhouse has given access to people who maybe, like you said, you're a speaker, you're a people person, you're talking, you want that feedback. But there are a lot of people that don't actually like that, you know, like being on your phone or whatever, like doing a video element, a visual element. And so this really gives a voice, quite literally, to folks who are maybe more comfortable just with the audio side of things. So I love that you said that. Meryl, I
love that I don't have to brush my hair too.
I know, right? No makeup. Don't even just roll out of bed. As long as you drink a little water so your voice is not crazy, you know, you're good to go. I love it. I love it. Well, Meryl, I want to thank you so much for being on the show as we start wrapping up here. If people are interested in working with you, because they can work with you in a number of different ways. And I think you really hit the nail on the head there at the end. Having someone, a coach, a mentor, someone in your corner to help you be a better business person, just like your dad said, and to kind of give you that advice and that guidance that you need from a business perspective, not just from a creative perspective, is super important. And we interview all sorts of pros here on this channel for that. But for folks wanting to reach out to you and tap in the incredible experience that you have, where can people find you?
They just Meryl at MerylSnow.com or MerylSnow.com. And it's very easy. Just fill out a form. And I always will talk to people free of charge for like a half hour, an hour. I mean, because some people just have a question or they need something right away or something like that. I have to give back to the industry because I had a mentor and he really helped me all through the way. And how do I repay him? And he says, you'll know when it's time to give back to the industry. And that was 10 years ago. I knew, okay, it's time. And I do give back to the industry. And because we've got to nurture this new generation that's taking over the industry. And I think that's really important for me and for a lot of us.
I love that. That is so encouraging.
And
that's
you're
so
the new inspiring. Generation. You're the
I
new
love
generation.
It. I'm here for it. Well, Meryl, we're going to have to stay in touch because I'm excited yes. to learn more from you. And I'm so thankful that we got connected. So thank you for coming on the show. I can't wait
thank
for
you.
Everyone to hear.
And Jonathan, keep in touch with me because I want to know how you work it out with your wife on who's doing what.
Absolutely. I will. Talk soon.
All right. Great.